Random House Audio presents Lincoln, A Biography by Philip B. Kunhardt Jr., Philip B. Kunhardt III, and Peter W. Kunhardt. Read for you by Frank Langella.
Lincoln, A Biography. Abraham Lincoln's trip east to assume the presidency of the United States began on the morning of February 11, 1861, and ended by the early light of February 23rd, 12 days in all. The journey took him from his home in Springfield, Illinois, along a great curving excursion through the American North. As the trip got underway, amid warnings and death threats, the state of the country was nothing less than precarious. The issue of slavery, for decades a cancer in the national tissue, was now finally threatening death to the Union. Upon Lincoln's election the previous November and ever since, the troubles had unfurled. On December 20th, South Carolina has seceded from the Union, setting off a chain reaction throughout the lower South. North and South now seemed irreconcilable. Accompanying Lincoln on the trip were his wife Mary and their three sons, Robert, Willie, and Tad. In town after town, Lincoln was met by tremendous crowds and taxing public ceremonies. At no other time in his life would he have to make so many speeches so close together. The speeches themselves were solid and good, filled with awareness of the great weight of the times. "There has fallen upon me a task such as did not rest even upon the father of his country," he said to one state legislature. Lincoln saw himself as an instrument who, with the help of the Almighty, was going to pilot the ship of state. "For if it should suffer shipwreck now, there will be no pilot ever needed for another voyage." Somewhere east of Albany, news reached them that former Secretary of War Mississippi Senator Jefferson Davis, a moderate who for some time had opposed secession, had been sworn in as president of what was called a new nation, the Confederate States of America, with its own flag and slavery-protecting constitution. Earlier, Davis had mocked what he considered the North's cowardice. Now, at the large inaugural ceremony at Montgomery, Alabama, Davis was predicting war, long and bloody. From this point on, the Lincoln journey took place under a gathering cloud. But still the crowds came out to celebrate their new leader. In New York City, where Lincoln had gained many admirers 12 months earlier at the Cooper Union address, crowds were waiting for his arrival with anticipation. Newspaper editor Horace Greeley released a front-page story in the New York Independent enthusiastically backing Mr. Lincoln in the face of a treasonous South. "The sole reason for all the hatred and malignity which now scowl upon him is this. He holds with the founders of this republic that human slavery is an evil to be circumscribed, not a good to be diffused and extended." The speech Lincoln looked forward to most of all, next to his inaugural, was the address at Independence Hall, Philadelphia, scheduled for Washington's birthday. He chose as his subject the sacredness of the Declaration of Independence. "I am filled with deep emotion at finding myself standing here, in the place where were collected together the wisdom, the patriotism, the devotion to principle, from which sprang the institutions under which we live. I have never had a feeling politically that did not spring from the sentiments embodied in the Declaration of Independence, giving liberty not alone to the people of this country, but hope to the world for all future time. It was that which gave promise that in due time the weights should be lifted from the shoulders of all men, that all should have an equal chance." On the night of February 22nd, not 12 hours after the Philadelphia speech, Abraham Lincoln hurried to his room, where he changed his clothes and wrapped himself up in a large overcoat. The president-elect walked out a side door of the hotel and approached a carriage. The regular presidential train would leave on schedule with fanfare in the morning. Lincoln was to be smuggled into Washington tonight. Word of an assassination conspiracy had arrived from two sources. The first was Scottish-born railroad detective Alan Pinkerton, who spoke of murderous Baltimore plug-uglies. The second, even more serious, came from old General Winfield Scott, who for months had been arming Washington in preparation for Lincoln's arrival and inauguration. The general warned of threats of mobbing and violence. Scott's friend, New York Senator William H. Seward, added that about 15,000 men were planning to blow up the railroad track and set fire to the train. Like Pinkerton, General Scott urged a secret night trip. With so many advisers pushing him, Lincoln finally agreed to turn himself over to the Pinkerton agency. Now, on the night of Washington's birthday, Lincoln was being spirited aboard a special single-car train in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, while expert pole climbers cut the telegraph wires leading out of the city. With secrecy thus guaranteed, the train, its car lamps unlit, pulled quietly out into the night. By 10 p.m., it arrived in West Philadelphia, where Pinkerton was waiting to escort Lincoln to a special sleeping car on the midnight train to Baltimore. The car had been reserved under a false name, supposedly for the use of an invalid who required special access through a rear door. Once aboard, Lincoln was pushed up into a sleeping berth far too short for him, so that his long legs had to be doubled up. The curtains were pulled shut on him, and everyone was ordered to be totally silent. Then, after an elaborate coded signal that Lincoln was safely on board, the train pulled out of the station. The only words spoken that night were by Lincoln, who couldn't help but crack jokes from time to time in the darkness. At 3:15 a.m., the train arrived in Baltimore, and Lincoln's car was hitched up to a team of horses and slowly pulled through the danger area to the Washington Depot. As they waited to begin the last leg of their journey, the clandestine group could hear a drunkard singing Dixie on the platform outside. In Washington, Lincoln was met by his old ally, Congressman Elihu B. Washburn, who heard Lincoln say that he was neither mournful nor chagrined at having sneaked into Washington. I thought it wise to run no risk where no risk was necessary. It had been a safe, if undignified, arrival, and Lincoln felt satisfied as he entered his suite in Willard's Hotel. Still, he could not escape the hatred boiling in so many American hearts, for there, awaiting him on a table, was a note threatening death if he didn't resign. On March 4th, Lincoln awoke in Washington to his inauguration day and to his address. No single speech of his had ever received the painstaking attention this one had. Now, on the morning of the inauguration, he gathered together his family and read it aloud to them. A little past noon, a worn-out President Buchanan arrived at Willard's Hotel to escort Lincoln up Pennsylvania Avenue to the Capitol steps. The horse-drawn carriage rolled past heavily guarded streets, with riflemen on the rooftops and great guns erected near the Capitol. Never before had an inauguration taken place in such an atmosphere. The city of Washington was unabashedly opposed to Lincoln and sympathetic to the South. Washington that day was tense, quiet, barely decorated. A sizable part of the crowd that had gathered for the address had been imported from the North. When they emerged onto the Capitol's east portico, Lincoln and Buchanan walked arm in arm. Around them were the giants of government, both new and old. Even Lincoln's old adversary, Stephen A. Douglas, was here. In the center of them all was Lincoln, dressed up in a new suit, hat, and boots, and carrying a gold-headed cane. Mary had thought he looked so good that morning, so dignified. The address was to precede the swearing-in ceremonies. As Lincoln approached the little table from which he would speak, several people saw Douglas reach over and take Lincoln's hat to hold throughout the ceremony. Others saw Lincoln pull out his steel-rimmed spectacles, which he needed for reading. Now Lincoln was in his element, speaking in the open air to a crowd. His high-pitched, passionate voice rang out like a bell across the silent crowds. It had been a dark, cold morning, but the sun broke out and beamed upon the listeners. Lincoln's speech was a strong, loving appeal to his countrymen and women to hold together in the dark times, to resist revolution, to trust to his goodwill. He called on all Americans to be friends, not enemies, for the Union depended upon it now more than ever. 30 minutes after he had begun, he closed with this appeal. In your hands, my dissatisfied fellow countrymen, and not in mine, is the momentous issue of civil war. The government will not assail you. You can have no conflict without being yourselves the aggressors. You have no oath registered in heaven to destroy the government, while I shall have the most solemn one to preserve, protect, and defend it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.